She committed a crime, went to prison, turned her life over to God while behind bars, and is now an author, a motivational speaker, a life coach, an MC, and a minister. How did she end up behind bars? How did she change her life? And what lessons can you and I learn from her? Stacy-Ann Garvey is my guest this evening. I'm Archibald Gordon, and this is Profile. Welcome to Profile.
Thank you for having me.
So you're an author, you're a life coach, you're a minister, you're an MC. You've done so many different kinds of things. When you look at where you are now in relation to where you're coming from, how do you feel?
To be honest, it's like trying to understand, you know, then and now. And, you know, it had to be a superior being. It had to be God, you know, coming in and taking over and just moving me from a mess to a message.
So let's talk a little bit about then. You grew up with your grandmother, and not so much, your mother was in the picture, but not as much as your grandmother. Why was that the case?
I mean, my mother had me young. She had me, I think she was about 16 or 17 when she had me. And so, you know, finances and, you know, just not being prepared to be a parent, really. So I moved around, you know, from being with mommy in Spanish Town, being in Vineyard Town, and then having to live with the grandparents in Yala. So I think finances played a role, but she was a very good mother. You know, she did her duty when she could. But it was more to the grandmother's side that, you know, most of the growing up came.
And that grandmother was very strict, you said.
Oh,
a lot of church.
A lot of church. Yeah, you had to, we went to church like probably 6 days out of the week.
6 days a week?
Yes.
What were you doing?
I mean, she would clean the church. She was in Women's Federation. She was in the prayer group. She was a part of the choir. And the list goes on. So she was always active at church. She always had something to do. She was always planning some church trip or something. So she was just always at church.
So you had this relationship with your grandmother and your mother at the same time. But you were telling me in the pre-interview that you didn't realize that your family structure was different than what other people had. What do you mean?
I think it was when I was a teenager, you know, I started reading those Mills and, I mean, if you're in your 30s going on to 40, you know what I'm talking about. But you start reading those Daniel Steele and Mills and Boone books. And I think it was when I was about 15, 16, when I went to church, I saw a family structure that I didn't realize, you know, was normal. And, you know, we got TV late, so we started seeing the soap operas when I was in my teens as well. So I saw parents, I saw a mother and a father. I saw children being loved and hugged and all of that. And, you know, I'm not saying this to say that, you know, the parents or the grandmother didn't love me. But there was something missing, you know, the hugs, the kisses, the conversations, even the little counselling and all of that. No one taught you how to be a teenager. Or, you know, no one really taught us about love. They cared because they fed us. But that was basically it.
You think part of that, you've said to me, is responsible or not understanding that dynamic was responsible for, you know, what then started to happen to you in terms of the relationships you started to develop with men?
I believe so. I think that, you know, my family wasn't really cultured. I mean, my mother had me young, her mother had her young, and my grandmother had my grandmother had a tribe of children. So, you know, my grandparents just knew how to feed us and take us to church and, you know, make sure that we had on clothes. But there was never that element of, you know, showing love and showing affection, you know, caring for the child other than feeding them and all of that. So, yeah, I would agree with you.
You sought that love and that relationship from elsewhere.
So the truth is, I grew up kind of different. I was always like this go-getter kind of person. And I believe, you know, if I see something and I believe that I should achieve it, I go after it. And that mindset can be wrong in a way if it's not guided. So I saw love and I wanted that. So I ventured out early, you know, finding that in a boyfriend that I was really not ready for. So I thought at 16, you know, I could venture for the boyfriend and get the white picket fence, become a wife and have the two children and the dog.
The kind of things you would have been reading in the Mills and Boons.
Yes, and fall in love forever. But, you know, that was really what really spiraled me down a wrong path in life.
Why do you say that? How did it spiral you down that path?
I mean, you know, I realized later on in life that, you know, all of that started with the whole rejection. And then, you know, not being able to receive from that situation, because it wasn't really a relationship, what I thought I could have gotten from it. You know, being left in the dark. I think there's a Celine Dion song that said that, left in the dark, something like that. But being left in the dark, you know, the gentleman walking away from me, it did something to my mind, it did something to my person. And, you know, I started getting depressed from that. I felt like I lost something that I was just going after. And it did something really horrible to me. And, you know, it really basically turned me into somebody that I really didn't know. You know, I got depressed. I went into another relationship for about 6 years, not being healed or even counseled from the first one. The first one, I would have had my first abortion as well. So I had all of those issues, you know, went and got into another relationship with somebody who had issues as well. And, you know, that didn't work out. In that relationship, I had a couple more abortions. And my life just went down a path of destruction. You know, I became a drug addict. I became an alcoholic. You know, I started being promiscuous, partying. It was just a mess.
Did you at any point stop or even understand what was really happening?
No, because the truth is I thought that all of those things that I was doing would heal me. I thought that the parting would make me feel better about myself. I thought that, you know, getting 15 tattoos and piercings and all of that would get me the attention to get love and, you know, nobody would leave me again when I'm the most irresistible person. So, you know, living that life, you don't think about, you know, the destruction or what's happening. You're just plunging deeper and you're trying to find that space where you're happy, you feel better. And I think that's how the drugs came in, because it does something to your mind. It takes you to this happy place, but then it wears off, you know. So it wasn't recognizing the path that I was traveling, but more just trying to feel better and trying to be better until I just got to a place of no return.
At the same time, you were having this parallel path that was taking place, because you had a career at the same time at this point.
I left high school at 18. I got my first job at 18 as well, which was really like a divine intervention. I wasn't even qualified. I left high school like 4 CXE subjects, even though I was a valedictorian, because that's what my family could afford.
This was Seaforth High?
Seaforth High School. Yes. Yeah, so, you know, I got my first job through Heart Trust NTA, which I got an award for as well, SL Tops program. And, you know, the company was very good to me. After the first year, I performed very well. And they actually kept me on staff, you know, after that. So I wanted to go to school. I've always wanted to do mass communications because of, you know, watching the news at an early age and seeing, you know, the Erica Allens and all of those people. So there's so much I wanted to do, but then my mind just got messed up and, you know, I started just wanting to feel better about myself and just forgot about all of those things.
So you were in this job, you were on a certain path, you were doing well initially. So how did Stacy-Ann Garvey move from this place of doing well initially into ending up behind bars? And then how did she end up turning her life around completely to the point where she's now a motivational speaker, she's a life coach, she's a minister? How did all of that happen? We're going to be hearing more about her story right after this break. Stick around, you're watching Profile.
Thank you.